Hello, I'm Jared Sartwell of Marvels of Biology, and today I'm joined by...
Dr. Roche, the physioscientist.
All right. So, Dr. Roche, the physioscientist, tell me a little bit about yourself and what you've done.
I'm a physiotherapist by training. I received a bachelor's degree in physiotherapy and then went on to do some post-professional training as well in physiotherapy. And then I went on to get a PhD in physical rehab science with a special focus on rehabilitation physiology.
Very nice, very nice. So, if I understand this correctly, today we have a little bit of a project. We're going to be going out to visit your friend, Jay Schrader, to talk about the topic of personalizing your own healthcare. Trying to educate yourself and determine the best course of action for how to make yourself healthy. Mm-hmm. So tell me a bit about that.
Yeah, so Jay is a good friend. We played in the same band together. And when it comes to personalized healthcare, I immediately think of Jay because he is someone who empowered himself to take control of his own healthcare and try to read and listen to commentaries and kind of customize his behaviors, mainly diet and exercise, so that he could change his health for the better.
Awesome. So that's a pretty difficult task. I think it's a daunting to a lot of people out there to even have the confidence to go about that, especially when there's so much information available. You've got to teach yourself how to weed through it, how to find reputable sources. On top of that though, even among reputable sources, sometimes there's conflicting information. Mm-hmm. So do you think there's any kind of underlying messages or take homes as far as how people should go to approach scientific dogma as a whole?
I'm glad you asked that. So because I trained in a physiology lab for about 12 years, I consider myself as much a physiologist as a physiotherapist. And to me, physiology is highly personalized. And I think that is the crux of personalized healthcare, to acknowledge that each person's physiology is different based on their genetics, based on how their physiology changes through lifespan, how their physiology changes due to life events. And I think that is the key. I think that's where the main issue is. And that's part of the reason why sometimes information can be conflicting, because you cannot just take a one-size-fits-all approach and apply it to everyone.
That's some amazing information you have there. Dr. Roche, truly a talented individual. I'm very happy to be able to work on this project with the physioscientist himself. So let's go and take to the field for your interview with Jay Schrader.
Let's head out.
Yeah. All right.
And I have with me today my good friend, Mr. Jay Schrader.
Hello.
So today we are going to be talking about personalized healthcare. And this is personalized healthcare not from the point of view of what healthcare professionals are supposed to do for their patients, but personalized healthcare in terms of an individual taking responsibility for their own healthcare and personalizing things like diet and exercise so that they can improve their health. So the reason why I have Jay with me here is because when it comes to taking control of one's own healthcare, to me, Jay is the perfect case study for it. We used to play in the same band, and we had some good fun playing music together. And while we were in the band together, Jay decided that he was going to change what he was doing in terms of diet and exercise. And I started seeing some radical changes in Jay's appearance and Jay's energy levels, and based on my conversations with him, I realized that he was also starting to improve his numbers in terms of his health. So we'll talk about a few specific historical events in Jay's health, especially pertaining to how things changed with Jay taking control of his own healthcare. So you know who we are now. So let's get to the next point. So Jay, what prompted you to empower yourself and take control of your own healthcare? Did you have any specific health condition that you were trying to change, that you were trying to beat? Tell us a little bit of where things were and what prompted you to take control of things.
So I've pretty much been overweight for almost all of my adult life, and I'm 53 years old. At age 45, I was diagnosed with type 2 diabetes, and a fairly moderate case of, I was on a long-acting insulin. Mm-hmm. I did that for 7 years, taking insulin, taking oral medications, and all the time it seemed like it was a downward spiral. Mm-hmm. I kept gaining weight, my numbers kept getting worse, I kept feeling worse all the time, and at some point I decided there's got to be a better way. Mm-hmm. I had lost considerable weight when I was about 39 years old. Mm-hmm. So I knew I could do it. If I really put my mind to it, I knew that I could do it. And mm-hmm. I remembered some of the things that had worked really well for me, mm-hmm. which was eliminating the grains, really focusing on meats and vegetables, mm-hmm. and exercising and lifting weights. And being as I knew that I could do it, I went that route again, where mm-hmm. I drastically changed my diet. I got rid of the grains, really focused on the proteins and the vegetables and the fats. And right after I started my diet change, I started resistance training again, mm-hmm. 3 or 4 days a week. Mm-hmm. And the combination of the two has made a great difference. I've lost about 40 pounds, and I've taken my A1C levels from the high 7s and low 8s down to the mid 5s.
Wow, so that's incredible.
My doctor's very happy with me.
That's great. I'm glad you mentioned your doctor. So conventional medical practice tells us that we should be avoiding fats just overall. They say keep your fat intake low. It's better to eat carbohydrate rather than fat. They might make a little bit of a concession and say, well, the fat that you get from something like salmon or avocado is good. Did your doctor actually advise you on this dietary change that you made, or did you just do it yourself?
No, this was all my doing. This was researching mm-hmm. by myself, and you know, you get contradictory stories, and you just gotta weed through it all and decide what works best for you and try things and see how you feel and see the results you get. And you know, like I said, my doctor keeps a close eye on my triglycerides and mm-hmm. all that, and so it's all stayed really well.
Excellent. I'm very happy to hear that your doctor is supportive of this, because some doctors, when they hear things like high-fat diet, they kind of put up their hands and say, I'm sorry, I don't want to work with you anymore, because they're afraid that under their watch you might develop further health complications. So it's very heartening to hear that your physician has been supportive of the choices that you made to improve your own health.
What I would say about that is I didn't ask her permission mm-hmm. for anything. I just went ahead and made changes, and 3 months in she saw results of, I'd lost 20 pounds and my A1C was much better, and she says, whatever you're doing, keep it up.
Wonderful. Yes, that's really, really nice to hear. And it is important that healthcare professionals listen to their patients, because I tell my students this all the time, that our patients are our most important teachers. If we stop listening to our patients, then we stop learning. So I'm so happy to hear that your physician was attentive to the changes that were actually visible and measurable after you had empowered yourself, taken control, and modified what you were doing in terms of your diet and exercise. So you did mention that your A1C levels were up in the 8+ levels. So we know that A1C is a good measure of blood sugar levels for about 3 months. It's a better test than just taking total blood sugar randomly. I think the fact that your A1C levels were in the eights and then they came down, I'm looking at your numbers, it looks like you've had an A1C reading of 5.4 in sometime last year, which essentially means that you were not diabetic anymore, which is amazing. So there is this notion in mainstream medicine that diabetes, whether it's type 1 diabetes or type 2 diabetes, is irreversible. That you have to acknowledge the fact that you have to live with it all your life, and that for the most part, you are going to be on some type of medication. What is your thought about this notion that it is a long-term, permanent condition that you cannot reverse? What is your thought about that?
My thought is that it's really a condition of insulin resistance. And I think that by changing your diet, by increasing exercise, by doing things to make yourself healthier, you increase your insulin sensitivity. And I think that's the real key to this, is having your body not be so resistant to the insulin. And it seems like, to me, the more I researched on my own, it seemed like taking insulin is kind of like giving an alcoholic a drink. They're gonna feel better, and maybe it treats the symptom temporarily, but ultimately it makes the problem worse, in that it decreases your sensitivity to the insulin by taking insulin. So that's my thought on it.
That's a great analogy. That is a very profound analogy, actually.
I'd heard somebody else say that. I didn't come up with that on my own.
Okay. You know, in terms of the science, what you say is spot on, because at least from what we know, there's a lot we don't know about diabetes, but at least from what we know, in type 2 diabetes, the problem is not a lack of insulin. And perhaps the problem is that there are these spikes in insulin levels really going too high because of the high glycemic index of the foods that we consume, causing the insulin receptors to lose sensitivity to insulin. In fact, you know, I recently read that people with type 1 diabetes who need insulin, they have to have insulin, without which they will not be able to perform normal physiological functions, even they can develop insulin resistance because of the insulin that they're receiving. I found that quite astounding, because I thought, well, they don't have insulin and they need it. They absolutely need it. There's no substitute for it. But even they can develop insulin resistance due to those boluses of insulin that they're getting as medication. So they're very interesting points. And I'm very grateful that you're sharing so much of wisdom that you've gained through reading, through observation, through listening. And I would say treating your body as a sort of personal scientific laboratory So that's really very, very impressive and heartening to hear from you. So let's talk a little bit about your diet. Like, what does your regular day-to-day diet consist of nowadays?
My day typically begins at 3 a.m. That's when I get up.
That's amazing.
I'm at the gym most days at 4, mm-hmm. get to work at 5, wow. and that's usually when I'll do any eating. Sometimes I'll have tree nuts, pecans, mm-hmm. almonds, that type of thing. Some days I'll have a quarter cup of cooked oats. Some days mm-hmm. I'll have some protein powder. Mm-hmm. And then I typically have a fairly large salad around 8 or 9 a.m. Mm-hmm. And that's always has fresh spinach in it, mm-hmm. and always has some protein, some cheese. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Usually chicken breast, but sometimes beef, sometimes other things. But mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. yeah, I crave those salads. Mm-hmm. That's just really, mm-hmm. that's probably my favorite meal of the day. That mm-hmm. morning, mm-hmm. that big morning salad. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And then 11:30, 12, I have a lunch, which is typically maybe 6 to 8 ounces of meat and a good portion of vegetables as well.
Wow, amazing.
And then my evening meal is typically somewhere between like 5 and 6 p.m. Mm-hmm. And that's the same kind of thing. Quite often I have some starch. I mm-hmm. maybe have mm-hmm. potatoes, sweet potatoes, mm-hmm. maybe rice. Mm-hmm. I try to avoid stuff like noodles. Mm-hmm. But I will definitely, I'll eat potatoes. Mm-hmm. Some type of starch with that mm-hmm. quite often. Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. Just to gain a little bit more insight, any particular reason why you choose sweet potato versus, let's say, corn or bread? Anything?
There? Yeah, it's a more complex carb. It's a carbohydrate, but it's more complex. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. It's not just gonna turn to sugar in your bloodstream right away. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
That's great. Since we're talking about diet, have you been asked to meet with a dietitian to discuss your diet?
No, I haven't.
Interesting. Very interesting.
Have you ever been? Well, I shouldn't say that. When I was first diagnosed with type 2 diabetes, my doctor did want me to go to diabetic training, and part of that was dietary training. Mm-hmm. And it was probably not that far off from what I'm doing now. They probably pushed grains more than what I would have, but mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. you know, just based on everything I read, but I never went to the classes.
Interesting.
So this is all just research I did on my own.
Okay. Interesting.
And trial and error, mm-hmm. to see mm-hmm. what my body agrees with. I'll say this though, too, is 5-6 years ago, I was having much more digestive issues, mm-hmm. not mm-hmm. feeling well. And at the time, I thought maybe it might have been lactose mm-hmm. issues. Mm-hmm. And I really, now looking back, I think it was more the grains. Mm-hmm. That really was the biggest thing. Getting the grains out of my diet has improved my digestion. Mm-hmm.
So we talked about diet. How about exercise? You already mentioned once that you do resistance training.
I do.
Roughly, what kind of a resistance training plan or program?
So my training program that I've been doing for the last year, I vary it some, but mm-hmm. it's basically a push-pull legs routine. Mm-hmm. So on my push days, I'm doing pushing exercises like bench press, mm-hmm. incline press, mm-hmm. military press, that type of stuff. On my pull days, I'm doing stuff like rows, mm-hmm. high rows, mm-hmm. Bicep training, pull-ups, mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. and then my third day is the leg training. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. So it's, you know, squats, mm-hmm. Leg press, all that type of stuff, calf raises.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. So this question is kind of, you know, personal to me because I'm a physiotherapist, or physical therapist as they call it in the United States. Have you consulted with a physical therapist to guide you through your exercise program?
No, I haven't.
Okay. How about a personal trainer? Did you have any consultation with a personal trainer?
No.
So even the exercise is kind of something you customized for yourself.
Yeah.
What kind of resources did you look into to develop this exercise program that you followed?
A lot of YouTube.
Okay.
Yeah,
okay.
A lot of YouTube.
Interesting.
The other thing I should really mention is for the last, even before I started weight training, I made it a habit for probably the last 4 or 5 years to walk every day on my lunch break.
Wow.
I walk about a mile. And
interesting.
I try to do that at least 5 days a week. Mm-hmm. Some days like today where we got really rotten weather, I won't go, but most days I really try to make an effort even through the winter. I also find that it helps me mentally and emotionally just to get out and get that fresh air in the middle of the day.
That's very encouraging to hear because physical therapists consider themselves as the go-to experts in movement. And one of our main missions is to promote safe and enjoyable movement. So to hear it from you that walking during your lunch break makes you feel physically well and mentally well, it's truly heartening.
Yeah.
Thank you for mentioning that.
For me, it's all about habit. If I don't do it the same time every day, then I'll put it off and then not get to it. And you know how that goes. If you skip a few days before you know it, you've skipped a few months. So that's something that I really try to remember all the time is make things a habit and keep them a habit.
Would you consider your resistance training program as high resistance, low repetition, or high repetition, low resistance?
I would consider it to be about in the middle.
Okay.
Most exercises, I would say I'm in the 10 to 12 rep range.
Okay.
But there are some that I purposely do more reps. One that I do is called a face pull, where it's a pulling motion like this up high, and I typically do higher reps with that.
Interesting.
I find it's just too hard to do, to keep my form and do low reps and higher weight with some exercises. Some exercises like a bench press, I'm fine with. If I can get 6 reps, I'm fine with that.
Very interesting. I must mention here that I myself follow a low glycemic diet. You could even call it a modified ketogenic diet, where I'm getting most of my calories from fat rather than from carbohydrate. And when I started that diet, I found that I was getting muscle cramps. Did you have this experience of muscle cramps?
No, I wouldn't say so.
Interesting, interesting. Do you feel that sometimes maybe being on this low glycemic, low carbohydrate diet is preventing you from increasing your performance in the gym?
Oh yeah, I definitely would agree with that. There's times when I purposely, like, I started including the cooked oats into my diet, especially post-workout in the morning. And I found that within a couple of weeks of doing that, I noticed a big difference in the gym with my strength.
Interesting. So in terms of where you want to take this next, what would be your next goal? What would be something that you would like to achieve next?
My next goal would really be to get down another 10 pounds. And eventually I'd like to get down maybe another 20 pounds even. But I'd like to get down another 10 pounds. I've been 6 or 7 pounds lighter than what I am right now. But I find it's difficult to maintain.
Currently, are you on any anti-diabetic drugs?
I am.
Okay.
I'm on metformin and I'm on Farxiga.
Okay.
And metformin. From what I've there were two that I actually agreed with my doctor that I would take. There were some drugs that I just flat out told her that I do not want to take these drugs. Wow. And from what I had read about metformin and Farxiga, was they actually helped with the insulin sensitivity. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. But I was not going to take any more drugs that actually did the reverse. Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. Have you had a conversation with your physician about potentially going off of all meds at some point?
Yeah, that is definitely, that's her goal and my goal. It's
very interesting.
To get off the medications altogether. And I think that is possible down the road.
Very, very good. So metformin and Farxiga. So, just from the little reading that I've been doing, I agree with you. Metformin does increase insulin sensitivity. Farxiga helps eliminate more glucose in the urine. Mm-hmm. Have you felt any side effects of either of these drugs?
No, I haven't.
Interesting.
I know I've read that with higher doses of metformin, sometimes you have stomach issues.
Yes, yes, yes.
But I only take it, once a day, mm-hmm. is all. I'm not sure about the milligrams, but mm-hmm. it's just mm-hmm. one tablet once a day. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
How about food cravings? Do you feel that, the general sense of being driven by hunger, has that changed since you switched?
Yes, it's drastically changed. Mm-hmm. I would say I'm far less hungry than I was 2 or 3 years ago. Mm-hmm. When I was eating grains and just basically, I was trying to lose weight. I really was trying. Mm-hmm. But when I was eating a type of, I guess you would say, a more traditional diet, mm-hmm. I felt like I was starving so much.
Right. Yeah, yeah. I find the same effect in my low glycemic diet or modified ketogenic diet. I don't feel hungry. I'm not driven by my hunger. When I do feel a sense of hunger, it probably is really because I have to eat. It's just time to eat. It's not like, oh, I have to keep thinking about food all the time. So that is very interesting. It's nice to know that, others who are on a similar diet have this positive experience. Yeah, so one thing I noticed about the change, the diet change from a carbohydrate-based diet to more of a fat-based diet, is that I had better mental clarity. I didn't get as anxious as I used to do before. Have you seen any of these mental health benefits with your modified diet?
I'm not sure about that. Mm-hmm. I was doing some intermittent fasting for a while, mm-hmm. where I was like 14 to 16 hour fast overnight. So I was putting off my morning meal for a few hours, mm-hmm. for probably like 6-7 hours after I was awake, mm-hmm. before I would eat. Mm-hmm. And yeah, at times I thought that maybe out there was some more clarity while I was doing that. Hmm. I haven't been doing that lately. It's just, that's rough.
Interesting.
I suppose some people get used to it. I never really got used to it. It was always a little bit hard to intermittent fast.
So you're saying that intermittent fasting was less helpful in terms of mental clarity, or more helpful?
I think it was more helpful.
More helpful, interesting.
I definitely think it was more helpful.
Interesting, interesting. Okay.
And I'd like to get back to that. Mm-hmm. I'd like to get to a point of doing a 24-hour fast, mm-hmm. once a week.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Do you ever check for blood ketone levels?
I don't.
You don't? Okay.
I don't check my glucose levels anymore either.
Okay, okay. It just whenever you have to get a checkup, you get your A1C levels checked.
Yeah.
And how often do you get your A1C levels checked?
I'm up to about every 6 months now.
Every 6 months.
When I was not doing good, it was about every 3 months.
Okay, okay.
But my doctor feels pretty confident now that 6 months were fine.
Great, great. So as we kind of come to the close of this chat, which I have found extremely enlightening. Mm-hmm. Are there comments that you would like to share? Do you have any advice that you would like to share with people who might be struggling with type 2 diabetes and really want to take control of their healthcare into their own hands and change things for the better?
What I would say is, from my experience, this is kind of what I did, is my doctor said, okay, you have type 2 diabetes. Okay, I'm going to prescribe you these medications, and I would like you to, you know, get a better diet and increase exercise. And I basically just took all that at face value and went along with it and figured, well, as long as I'm taking the medications, I'm getting better. Mm-hmm. And I wasn't feeling better. And so I think it behooves a person to find out as much information as you can on your own. And like I said, you're going to find conflicting information sometimes, and it's your job to weed through it. But, you know, we only get so many trips around the sun, and we want to make them count. So.
Wow, I just love that. Did you practice that sound bite?
No, I didn't. Is
that an original? Or did you come up with that, the trips around the sun sound?
No, I think I've heard somebody else say that too, but it's kind of really profound, especially I just lost my father this year. And
wow, sorry to hear that.
Yeah, and mm-hmm. You know, we only get so many laps and then mm-hmm. it's over, mm-hmm. so let's try to feel good and make the most of it while we're here.
That's really, really very profound. I think I'm going to use this line that you brought up. As long as I'm taking the medication, I'm getting better. I think many of us just implicitly trust our healthcare team to be doing right by us. And I think very often our healthcare teams are doing what they think is best for us. But somehow something seems to be going wrong, especially with conditions like type 2 diabetes. I have people close to me, members of my extended family, who are struggling with it. And sometimes the struggle is the conflicting opinions that they're receiving. But I would like to hearken back to something you mentioned very early on, and that is to empower yourself by learning, by gaining as much knowledge as you can gain about your condition, about what your body is trying to tell you, and to try things for yourself, to really try things for yourself and see what really works. And I think that is the crux of personalized medicine, starting from the individual itself. I think we cannot just surrender our healthcare to healthcare professionals and just take their advice and run with it. I think there is that responsibility that we have to use the knowledge that we start gaining from perhaps kindergarten. My daughter just started kindergarten. They're learning about the human body at the kindergarten level. We are learning science in school, not just to learn and forget, or not just to pass exams, but to improve ourselves, the health of ourselves, the health of society. So I'm incredibly grateful to you for highlighting these points.
You're welcome.
And I think my students and whoever hears this chat, this interview, would be very grateful too. So thank you so much, Jay. I really appreciate it.
You're welcome.
Thank you.